everyone. I'm Maria. It's easy, everybody can say that. But I would like you also to call me Evgenia. This is the version of my name in Russian. So if you want, you can also call me Evgenia. So I'm going to talk about myself with the status of nuclear field in my country, Brazil. I'll try to be brief, so if I be more than 5 minutes, you can raise your hand, and then I will know that it's been 5 minutes already. So I'm a nuclear physicist. I'm currently living in Germany, and yes, I'm also currently looking for knowledge and professional opportunities. How can I change the slide? So, about the nuclear fuel cycle in Brazil, we have the company called Brazilian Nuclear Industries. It's related to our regulatory body, the Brazilian Nuclear Energy Commission, and it's part of our Ministry of Science, Technology and Innovation. Okay, here I've put a picture of the uranium concentrate unit. That's where I worked for almost 2 years. It has the capacity of production of 400 tons of yellow cake a year, but right now they are trying to open new mines and we are not producing that right now, but that's how they can do it. And that's a picture of me with the people from the radiation protection licensing coordination. Okay. I said a nuclear fuel cycle. These nuclear industries of Brazil, they are responsible since from the mining and milling of uranium ore until the fuel assembly. So I don't know if you know about it, but in Brazil, all the nuclear field, it's part of the government. We don't have private companies related to it. So this company is responsible for the whole fuel cycle in Brazil. About the power generation, we have the company Eletronuclear. It's related to Eletrobras. It's a company from the government, and it's responsible for all the electricity generation, transmission, and distribution. So it's part of the Ministry of Mines and Energy. Here I have a picture of the site. We have two nuclear power plants already. And the third one is under construction. I've written the capacity right now. We have the Angra 1 capacity is 640 megawatts electric. It's from Westinghouse technology. And the Angra 2, it's already Siemens technology. Also, Angra 3 will be the same. But unfortunately, I don't know if you know, Brazil is going through a very critical political crisis, so Angra 3 has to wait a little bit. It was supposed to start on 2018, but now we have to have a late schedule. That picture I'm with the monitoring management, the superintendent of Eletronuclear, and also the head of the division of radiation protection. This day we put the old head of the reactor vessel of Angra 1 in its intermediate disposal area. So I've worked with the Eletronuclear team for 3 outages. In one of them, we had the replacement of the reactor vessel head. So the Brazilian nuclear program is developed by the Navy. The Navy is related to the Ministry of Defense. And it's mainly developed by the Navy Technological Center in São Paulo. São Paulo doesn't have a sea, so that's where our research and development of the nuclear program happens. Okay. This picture is of the site where Lab Jean is going to be built. It's also late on the schedule because, as I said before, we are going through a very delicate situation, political situation. So everything on nuclear field right now has been suspended. And this picture, I'm with the head of the Navy Technological Center in São Paulo, the project manager and the project coordinator of LabGen, and also the head of Instrumentation and Control Division. This was my farewell lunch. So that's why nobody's wearing the Navy clothes. And we cannot take pictures like that. So about the research institutes, they are always related to the Brazilian Nuclear Energy Commission and also universities. And here I present a picture of RMB. It's our multipurpose reactor that is supposed to be built. And its main purpose is the production of molybdenum. That's what my master thesis was about. In this picture, we are in IPEN. It's the first option. It's University of São Paulo, and we are in the Nuclear and Energy Research Institute. This facility is also late on schedule, and we hope that in 2023, it's already almost built. So, a little bit about me. I've worked with radiation protection and licensing in many facilities, especially in mining and mining of uranium ore, and also during outages. These last 3 years I worked with instrumentation and control in the Navy. And my expectations for this school are getting as much knowledge as I can and know as many people as I can. So thank you very much for your time and your attention, and I hope you all to have a very good week. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina, for well structured presentation and well formulated expectation. Well done, like Olympic Games. Yes, well done. So the next presenter is Mr. Peter Kazanitsky from Slovakia.
I didn't have time to prepare it because I just came to Petersburg right from vacation. But anyhow, I'll try to introduce myself briefly and also all of the points. So my name is Peter Kazanitsky. I'm from Slovakia and I'm currently working in Slovenské elektrárne, which is part of the NL group and also of the EPH Energy Group from the Czech Republic. I'm currently the manager of the security and services. So security and services means basically everything which is related to the classified information, to the emergency protection or preparedness and response, also to the physical protection of the power plants and of all of the assets, and also services connected with the support of the generation unit. Slovakia is one of the countries where nuclear power plants have been operating for several decades, so we are not one of the developing countries. We actually have four blocks currently running in Slovakia. There are the Russian technology DDER-440, and we are building two new blocks which should be operating from the middle of next year, and another one from the middle of the year after that. And the expectation from the school, from my point of view, is to build as large network of people as possible, the experts in the nuclear field, to exchange experiences, and to also learn from the organizers, from the Russian experiences. That's all from my side.
Thank you. Well formulated expectation to learn from Russian parties, right? And to make a larger networking. So, next presenter is Mr. Shpuntov, Republic of Belarus.
May I speak from here?
It's better. Good enough,
not?
There. Yeah, we have some cameras.
I don't need microphone. I'm
not sure.
I work at Belarus nuclear power plant. It is in construction now, and my responsibility is educational and methodological support of training center. Some words about myself. I graduated Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology, and my second education is a lawyer. 18 years I worked in ABB and worked for traditional power segment. Then I had certain experience in wind energy, solar energy, and finally came to nuclear energy. Maybe that is not very traditional for nuclear persons, but okay. What is Belarus actually? That is small country, not so much famous like Russia or Brazil. And you can see it's green color. And Petersburg is a star here. And our nuclear power plant, Ostrovets site, is located near the Lithuanian border. There were two other locations possible, but they were rejected due to some geological reasons. And we are not far from Vilnius, capital of Lithuania, and it makes us a lot of problem with Lithuanian guys. They cry too much about nuclear danger. And actually we have no raw materials for nuclear energy. We have no educated personnel, almost no expert general physicist educational. And in 1970s we had a project to build up a power plant to give electricity and heat to the capital of Belarus, the city of Minsk. But after Chernobyl disaster, this project was cancelled, and for 20, maybe even 30 years, we had no actually project to come to a nuclear society. And in 2004, we started preparation activity for nuclear power plant construction. And in 2007, it was the first state document concerning nuclear power development. Then there were some official preparation, and finally we signed a contract with Rosatom to build up nuclear power plant in Belarus. It will be two units, each one 1,200 megawatt, and now we are in construction stage. There are some milestones of construction, maybe that is not so interesting, but actually in 2020 we must have our plant in operation, and now I show how it looks like. Everything is in construction, a lot of noise, a lot of dust, but also very nice order of the construction site. I was really impressed. I have seen a lot of construction sites before, but these Rosatom guys, they know what to do. That's power unit number one, reactor building. That's power unit number two, without cupola. Construction of power crane. Operation cool towers. One is already finished and the next one is coming to finish. And our main task at the moment is organization of training, because, okay, construction will be done. Rosatom people know what to do, and yeah, there are some problems, but we overcome them. But the main problem for us is training of personnel, because we have approximately 70 guys, let's say, invited from Russia, Ukraine, to operate at the most critical positions. But the rest we have to prepare in this short period. And that is really very challenging. We have already done commissioning full scope operation, full scope training machine, and some other training machines, local training machines, and actually we will hardly about training of personnel. Oh, sorry, I did something wrong. That is industrial base for nuclear power plant. And where we live here, some nice pictures. So my expectation is, of course, to increase knowledge about present state, present situation in nuclear power generation, and better understand position and role of international agency, and how we can cooperate better, and structure various ideas of nuclear education and knowledge management, because there are too many ideas and it's necessary to make order in brains. And of course, to improve knowledge of safety and security in nuclear activity. Thank you very much.
You understand, the idea of introduction is just to understand the background. So I'm very much astonished with your background. So you graduated from FISTEC. You didn't mention about your specialization.
Sorry?
Ваша специализация?
Engineer
physicist. Physicist, nuclear physics.
General
physicist, yes. Thank you.
Not very good.
I understand the expectation from your presentation. More nuclear, yes. Thank you. Thank you. So we waived the Q&A session with the self-introduction, because you have a lot of chance to get familiar with each other, to shake hands and initiate the discussion. Just introduction, very good. Next point, the next speaker is Mr. Jubair Seed from Bangladesh.
I'm going to talk about, first of all, my introduction and then the current status and future plan of the nuclear power program of Bangladesh. You know, Bangladesh is going for the nuclear and we are going to start the main construction very soon. I am working as a nuclear engineer in the nuclear power and energy division. They are going to work as the operating organization for the future nuclear power plant of Bangladesh under Bangladesh Atomic Energy Commission. Basically, I am an electrical and electronic engineer. I graduated from the main engineering university of our country, Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology. Later, I got my master's degree in nuclear engineering. It was the first nuclear academic program in our country, and that was offered by University of Dhaka, the oldest university in our country as well. And before that, I had a small experience, about 5 years in the academia. I worked as a lecturer and as an assistant professor as well for electrical and electronic engineering. Later, after getting my master's in nuclear engineering, I also served some time as an assistant professor in a university. But due to huge demand in the operating and the construction company, I have switched from academia to the professional arena. Currently, I'm working in the construction of Rupur Nuclear Power Plant project as a nuclear engineer. And my specific division is engineering coordination. Our prime responsibility is currently review and negotiate and finalize the different contracts. Because our main contractors are the Russian side, JSA Akanostroy Export, and most recently we are finalizing the contract for nuclear fuel supply for the lifetime operation, in addition operation and maintenance contract, and spent nuclear fuel management contract. In addition, I am also involved in the design and safety related documents reviewing process, which include the technical assignment for development of the design documentation of our PHR nuclear power plant. And currently I am working with the review and finalizing process for the preliminary safety analysis report PSR and probabilistic safety assessment. These documents, these are very necessary for getting the license, the design and construction license. We already achieved the site license few months back, so we are currently going through the design process and finalizing it. From this specific program, I would like to share my experience with the other newcomer, potential newcomer countries, and also the experienced countries, because as a newcomer country, we are facing several challenges. We may be good in the theoretical field, but in the practical arena, there are several challenges, and there are several ways to overcome those challenges. So my prime intention and prime expectation from this program to find out the ways to overcome the barriers, the primary barriers to deploy nuclear power for the first time. This is a picture of me in the last negotiation meeting. It is a joint coordination committee meeting between Bangladesh and the Russian Federation. It was held 2 months back. Now I am going to give an idea of the nuclear power program of our country, the present status and the future plans. And we thought about nuclear power long way back. In the 1961, the site was preliminarily selected, the Rupur site. It is around 160 kilometers away from the capital city Dhaka, in the district of Pabna. But since then, due to some political unrest and other problems, we couldn't materialize it. In the last 10 or 15 years, we have become very aggressive and we are now going to implement the nuclear power program. The first main initiation that started this current phase was in 2011, when we signed an intergovernment agreement with the Russian Federation to construct and coordinate in the construction of Rupur nuclear power plant in Bangladesh. We see the Rosatom DG is signing the document, and from Bangladesh side, our Ministry of Science and Technology is there present. Currently, the preliminary activities are going on, and we have a credit agreement with the Russian side of amount $500 million to complete the preliminary task, and which include the background study, some engineering survey, preparation of the EIA report, in addition feasibility evaluation, first priority design and working documentation preparation, in the licensing documents, TSR, PSR, etc., and some soil stabilization for the site is currently going on. I'm going to show you some pictures of the activities done so far. The picture of the pioneer base and the assembly base are shown here. There's a watchtower, lighting tower, the monitoring base, warehouse, administrative buildings, some canteens, pump stations, storage tank, warehouse, access control, laboratories are also being done. The periphery activities are currently going on, and these are supposed to be completed by December 2016. And after getting the soil stabilized in our Rupur site, we are going to start the main construction. The general contract for main stage construction was signed last year, on the 25th December. The contract price is $12.65 million. It includes some infrastructure development activities as well and training of the personnel for operation. We also got the state credit agreement for financing in last July. In that contract, the Russian government will provide 90% credit for the contract price. That is one of the main concerns from our side to materialize this plant. Some technical parameters of our Rupur NPP. There will be two units, each of the basic design is AS2006, the BVR1200 model, generation 3 plus. The reference plant is Novogorod NPP2. We have some other parameters, seismic impact, aircraft crash. These are as per the site-specific parameters in addition to the reference plant design. And the service life will be more than 50 years, we hope so. And the power unit capacity will be roughly around 1200 megawatt each. The schedule of construction for our Upper Nuclear Power Plant. The first unit will start construction from the next year. The FCD date is 1st of August 2017. And after fuel loading startup, provisional takeover, we are expecting to connect to the grid by 2023. The second unit will follow 1 year later in each stage almost. And we, Rupur Nuclear Power Plant is our long dream, long cherished dream. And we hope to get this nuclear power plant in due time and use this nuclear energy for peaceful purpose and make our country a prosperous and a prosperous one in near future. And I would like to contribute to my fullest and get our long cherished dream come true. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Just a very small question. So the situation is ongoing in the process. When you sent your people to be trained in Russia under the EPC contract?
Under the EPC contract, we have a provision to train up to 1200 people in Russian Federation. And the schedule is starting from December this year.
This year, December?
The first group is coming December this year.
So first team coming. Thank you. Thank you. So the next speaker is Mr. Karanja, Kenya. Kenya.
On this basis that we came up with the idea of bringing in nuclear energy. Now that is the future demand of our electricity, and what maybe we expect that maybe because we have a lot of geothermal energy, we are going to tap that. But second on the list, by 2030, we expect nuclear to have taken up and gone for. Currently, we only have mainly, we are dealing more on geothermal and hydro. We also want to generate some energy from wind, but all the same, we have nuclear in our plan. Now, the establishment of NEP, as I said, we started in 2030, where we came up with a nuclear electricity project committee in 2010, and it was later transformed to Kenya Nuclear Electricity Board in 2012. Now, the main responsibility is to promote and expedite the development of nuclear electricity in Kenya, and that is our core mandate. In our work, we have adopted the milestone approach. I know some of you are conversant with it, but at the moment, we are in phase one. For us, I would say we have already started the journey. Right now, in fact, even by last week, I am sure there was a meeting done by all stakeholders to ensure we kind of finish up with a bill we want to give to the parliament, so that we can be able to end the nuclear law, to be able to establish the regulator. I think that one has been handled. In fact, last week there was a seminar regarding that. But briefly, I'm saying that we are within the first phase. We are doing the considerations before the decision to launch a nuclear power program, and I can assure you we are moving, we are on track. Don't need to. So I have shown where we are. We are there within the first phase, and I can assure you that we are just about to make that commitment, and very soon we should do that. Activities of the board. Now, since 2010, we have been able to engage the stakeholders, because we need consensus as a country that this is the way we are going. That way we have done it quite well. HRD, that is human resource development, we are progressing well. We have had some help from the outside the country, and also within the country, the board is also sponsoring some students, the University of Nairobi. We have a strategic plan. That one has already been dealt with, or rather that one is already on record. We have taken a plan for the next 15 years. We have some few MOUs, and we have already undertaken the first innovation. We have done the pre-feasibility study. We have done some initial site study. We are still in the process of doing reactor technology assessment, and we have nuclear regulatory bill. I'm telling you that nuclear regulatory bill is in the process. Yes? Okay, I'm just about to finish. So I think the last milestone too will approach that in the order. But generally, at the moment, we are also doing some strategic environmental assessment. That's a key thing we are doing. We are also doing some comprehensive site selection process right now. That's undergoing. We are developing some national strategy for radioactive waste management, emergency preparedness, that will start probably by next year. There are several activities we are undertaking. I think you can see them there. And maybe finally, what I want to say, we have the backing of our government. It is committed to follow this to the very end. And I'm sure, God willing, and as we are aspiring by 2027, maybe something we should be able to commission our first nuclear power plant. What I would suggest here, and what is our wish, is that we need the international support, and we thank you for the past support. And the other thing is that there is need for the developed and emerging nuclear power countries to share the best practice and advice on the technology with their banking countries. My expectation, first, is to have a lot of knowledge, and my expectation is broad and wide. Of course, I need to interact with those who have been there, those who are coming, upcoming like us. We have a lot to share in common. But a key thing is that we need best practices to establish the NPP with the new embarking countries, roadmap to develop an empowering learning institution, so as to respond to emerging this quarry endowed with human resources in this youth, hence the need for collaboration with more endowed partners. I'm sure with that, as Kenyans, we are going to benefit. I also have some expectation to understand the IAEA laws with respect to NPP for the newcomer countries, basic principles of nuclear power development, nuclear power vis-a-vis other energy sources, and the economic of nuclear power. I think I have a lot of expectation, and from the onset I feel that I'm in the right place. Otherwise, thank you for listening, and thank you once again. God bless you.
Thank you very much. Clear understanding. I found myself that the role of IE is also one of the targets of your participant. So that's a good symbol of joint cooperation with the agency. So the next speaker from Indonesia, Mr. Halim Marti.
Okay, good morning everyone. Let's start. I briefly introduce myself. My name is Alim Mardi. You can call me Alim. I'm from Indonesian National Nuclear Energy Agency. I have background in mechanical engineering. And then I have been graduate also from Master of Science in Nuclear Technology, especially in Nuclear Security and Safeguard Program. Currently, I am a researcher in safety, specialist in mechanical integrity of structure of material. But after I have graduated my master, I have been involved with the security, nuclear security research. Currently, my position is as a staff of project management office. I have responsible with the security and safeguard document licensing. Okay, briefly, the current status of Indonesian nuclear infrastructure. First, we have been engaged with the nuclear program long time, since 1954. In 2007, our government have been produced the Act number 10/2007, which is the new energy law. In this act, it has been mandated that for the long-term project in Indonesia must be established a nuclear program as a one of the alternative renewable energy. Its nuclear energy has a contribution in 7% of our energy, national energy. In 2009, Indonesia was invited the INIR program, Integrated Nuclear Infrastructure Review, and we have a phase one. So, means that with a little preparation, we can go through the phase two. In 2014, our president has declared that Batan as a support organizations in nuclear, so it should establish a new power reactor as mandated in Act number 10/2007. But due to the budget, our president consider that we establish the small one, we call experimental power reactor. We have been decided that we signed a contract with Rosatom also. We signed a contract of conceptual design of HTGR. Right now, since 2014 till right now, we have intensive collaborations with the international and the national organizations to establish this project. We hope that in 2000, right now the status is we established a preliminary document. The site licensing is already submitted to the regulatory body, but from the early of this year, we make a document for licensing. We hope that in the last of this year, we can submit all of the document to the regulatory body, and we expect it's parallel that in the 2017, Mr. President has been decided which one the organization or maybe construct the first of experimental power reactor. I think my expectation for this program that I want to match what I have known about the nuclear program and then upgrade my knowledge. So when we make a document, we can exactly know that we are on the right way due to the IAEA guidance. Thanks for all. We hope that you enjoy these sessions. Thank you very much.
Terry Mukashi, the Indonesian language. Thank you.
Thank you,
So, next speaker, Dr. Tariq Nanda from Egypt. Mr. Tariq Nagla, Egypt. Ilusha.
Tariq Nagla.
Ilya. Audio. Sorry for techniques, sometimes technology doesn't have properly. So, ready? Okay, let's start.
Good morning, Dobro Utro. My name is Tariq Nagla from Egypt. I am graduate from nuclear engineering, Alexandra University, My experience in nuclear engineering about 25 years. I am working in the Nuclear Power Plant Authority in Cairo. My lecture about Egyptian country report. In the first, I thank Rosatom and IAEA for invitation for me and my friend, engineer Mohammed Kamal. This is the figures here, the Rosatom communication with IAEA for this conference, and Arabic Republic of Egypt, Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energy. This is agency related to produce electricity in Egypt, and sub from this is agency, Nuclear Power Plant Authority. This is for nuclear power plant for produce electricity. This is the figures here, the position of Egypt relative to the all world. And this is the map for Egypt. Appear in the top top of the west. We need to build about four units in Al-Daba site with communication with Russia group, specialist for Rosatom. In this map, we can see the Red Sea in the east sides and the Mediterranean Sea in the north. When study the soil mechanics and geographic, we can see in the red side, see this is seismic regions, and also in the Sinai, and in the west deserts here, underground water. And in the position of the Nile River, this is regions restricted to build any nuclear power plant in these regions. For these reasons, select the Daba site on the Mediterranean Sea, the site capability for about four units. For any information about Egypt, you can go to this link. This is the figures appear about the old historical Egyptian forest. This is the figures appear in the background, the title of Rosatom. This is Nuclear Week in the Alexandria University in Egypt, cooperation with Rosatom. And this is the figures appear display the big communication between Egyptian and Russian groups. I'm training in Russia from 6 years ago. This is the figures, the big communication relationship between Egyptian Sisi resident and modern resident Russia. Because the Egyptian is high numbers of people, about 19 million people in Egypt, we need to increase the power every year, and we go to the nuclear power plant and renewable energy for increase this is population. This is statistical data for participation of each power plant, hydraulic, thermal, and renewable and nuclear energy expected in the future about 5 gigawatts. This is historical nuclear power plant project in Egypt. You can display fast. Now we big communication with Rosatom, with NPPA, and this is work at triangle with IAEA as recommendations and support for this is Egyptian project. We near 1 year time, we go to the final EBC contract. And thank you again for Rosatom for invitation. The next speaker, Mr. Henry Lampetta from Zambia.
The legal framework.
We also need the, of course, that to culminate from the policy itself. So, and again, we do not have the expertise, the necessary expertise to push this program forward. So there's a lot of things that we need to put in place. Maybe as a preview, right now we are importing electricity, very expensive electricity from Mozambique and South Africa, and that has taken a serious toll on our budget, the budget for last year and the budget for this year. And of course, the pricing structure in terms of electricity is quite low because most of it is subsidized by our government. So we are talking of 7 cents per kilowatt hour instead of 12 to 15 kilowatts per hour, which is quite low. So we need to, as a country, really, we need to work so hard and make sure that, a lot of things are put in place, so much so that even when, players come into the sector, they should be able to realize their investment and, of course, make sure that in the next few years, we project that the national consumption for electricity will be 7,000 megawatts. So really, you can see that, in fact, what we need is, with no doubt, nuclear energy. And I wish to thank Rosatom at this point to provide Zambia with about 7 scholarships to train our undergraduates to pursue the nuclear energy. Of course, that cooperation is going to continue, but then we also need to make sure that at the apex, the people that are going to push this agenda are well trained at that level in the field of nuclear energy, so that the setting up shouldn't be, should not have bottlenecks or should not, meet a lot of resistance. Now, are Zambians going to wait? Because if you look at what we are using right now in some sectors, we have a mix of energy. We have fossil fuel generated power, and of course, that one has attracted a lot of dogs, meaning that, over the years we have to scale down on that. But then, are Zambians going to wait for us to, or going to just fold their arms and say, let's do away with fossil fuel? The answer is no. That's why my president, the Zambian government president, is up in arms to say, we need to start the programs now. Even if it takes 15 years, by that time, of course, you won't be in power. The tone has to be set. And the tone has to be set now, because we can't wait until we have serious more deficits in terms of power. What's our expectation, or my expectation, from this training program? I'm using our because we pleaded with Rosatom to give us 8 slots, but I think it was difficult for Rosatom to do that. But next time, please increase our slots so that we have a mix of experts to carry the program forward, because we are newcomers. We need a lot of knowledge and a lot of impetus in that regard. So what's my expectation from this training program? One is, of course, to look at the fears that our citizens have, because this is The fear is the concentrated levels of radiation that currently we have. By the way, Zambia has rich deposits of uranium right now, but the mining is going up, but it's most of it is being powered. So there are fears that this, what we are trying to start, you know, we will subject our people to a lot of radiation. Number two, how to develop necessary expertise to for the self-disposal of the radiation waste. That is very, very important. Number three, how best we can get assistance to have a definitive nuclear policy and also the necessary legal framework. Number four, we need to appreciate the international existing procurement procedures for Zambia to adhere to at the time that we will be procuring the plant. And five, what are the existing financing options available? Of course, our country is very poor. We can't have the money to put up a plant, so we need to, of course, run to our big brother, Russia, to make sure that they help us in terms of technical and financing in that regard. Number six, whether Russia through Rosatom has any technical assistance to newcomers in the leadership and management of nuclear expertise, because Zambia, of course, as I said, do not have that expertise to push the agenda or the nuclear agenda forward. Thank you so much for listening, and God bless.
Thank you. We have 4 minutes before the lunch time, so one presenter, let's make a chance to speak to us. There is Mauhat, Cambodia.
Thank you, Professor Chia. I'm Hak Mau from Cambodia. I'm a Deputy Director of Technology and Science Department. Actually, I don't have any background related to energy in nuclear. I'm the expert on low carbon development or climate change mitigation. I just graduated for my PhD from Japan just last 5 months. Actually, Cambodia haven't developed any nuclear power. We just initiated this concept in late last year with the Russian Federation. And the main purpose of our cooperation is to build human resource and also to share knowledge and to raise public awareness among our people. And for the expectation of this program, I just want to learn from the presenters as it is a new field for me, and to see, based on our field visit, how they contract the facilities, and based on the lesson learned and also the practical experience through the field visit, I will provide a recommendation to the government. What should we do for the next step? Thank you.
Which kind of university, which kind of specialization you go from Japan?
Low carbon development, climate change mitigation.
Okay, okay. Which university?
Kyoto University.
Kyoto University, very famous. Thank you. So, lunchtime. Yes. Yeah, make an announcement.